If you're watching this video, I'm willing to bet that you're ready to go take someone's deposition. If that's the case, we gotta make sure we check off some formalities. And in this video, we're gonna cover exactly that. In particular, how to get a deposition set up and making sure that there aren't any technical issues with that. But first, we obviously gotta roll the intro. Welcome to Law Venture. My name's Jarrett Stone. I'm the owner of Stone Firm PLLC. And in this video, we're talking about how you can get your deposition set up appropriately. That way there aren't any technical issues and you don't have any delays and you can go dominate your next deposition. But for those that are watching this video on YouTube, there are three things I need to mention. First, you obviously need to hit the like button down below that helps support the channel, that allows this video to rank higher, ultimately reach more people, and ultimately help more people. That's always the goal. Second, be sure to click the subscribe button down below. In doing so, that allows you to see future content once it's rolled out and released. And third, there should be something maybe hitting me in the head right now, sliding above, that something is a link that'll take you to my free online course about depositions. Because the video you're watching right now is actually one of the lessons inside this free online course about depositions. So by clicking the above link, heading over to lawventure.com, checking out the free online course on depositions, not only are all the videos gonna be compiled in a seamless and logical order to where you can start from beginning to end, get your fix on depositions, but you're also going to be able to maximize this YouTube material. Because while on YouTube, it's great, you get to find me, you get to do your little searches, you get to hit the like button, you get to subscribe. That's kind of the extent of your ability to get the most out of this material. But over on lawventure.com with these online lessons, you can go into the body of the lesson, you can get additional information, you can download some freebies, and you can take the content to the next level and really get your fix on everything you need to know about depositions. Okay, so it's time to talk about how you can get your deposition formally set up, because you simply just can't say, hey, let's have the deposition on this day and then just hope everyone arrives. If you do that, you're not gonna have a good time. It's not going to be a fun deposition because most likely nobody's going to arrive other than maybe the court reporter who is still going to expect to be paid some portion for just simply arriving. So let's make sure everything is checked off. You don't wanna have any technical issues by going through some of these formalities, and that way you're smooth sailing from this point forward. I'm gonna be totally upfront here. We're talking about formalities and technicalities before we start talking about all the fun stuff involving depositions in future lessons. So if I were to give you an analogy here, this particular lesson is, let's make sure you eat your veggies before you end up eating all the fun desserts. So, with this said, make sure that as I go through this checklist and I bring up things to consider when it comes to getting your deposition set up, double check everything with your jurisdiction, because I plan on giving you general things to know, but I want you to make sure that it all applies to your specific case and your specific jurisdiction. That way you're not missing any type of technicalities, formalities that need to be checked off before you go dominate that deposition. So the way to formally set up a deposition is to send what's called a notice of deposition. So a quick distinction that needs to be made here, because I don't want to oversimplify it and then lead you astray. If you're trying to set up a deposition with somebody who is a party to the case, so the opposing party, then what you're gonna do in that situation is send the opposing party's counsel, assuming they have representation, that notice of deposition, and that notice of deposition is going to basically solidify and formally set up that deposition. Put an asterisk there because we'll talk about the formalities in a little bit. Now, that's a little bit different compared to trying to take a deposition of a witness who is not a party. So on one hand, we had a party. On the other hand, we have a non-party and just a witness who knows some aspects of the case, has some knowledge, or maybe doesn't have any knowledge. You just need to flesh that out. In that situation, I would say 10 times out of 10, but maybe there's a jurisdiction out there that is more 9 times out of 10. I don't know. But in most situations, what you're gonna need to do with the non-party witness is to also send a subpoena with that particular notice of deposition, and then check your jurisdiction to figure out what hoops have to be jumped in order to have that subpoena be legitimate, in order to have that subpoena also exercise the court's power on that particular witness. For example, in some jurisdictions, you're required to not only file the subpoena with the court, but also to send the subpoena in advance to opposing counsel. Again, check your jurisdiction to figure out what all you have to do, what hoops you have to jump through to make sure you can get that witness deposed. There's a third variation here that you should consider. It may or may not apply in your case, but it's something that you should be aware of, something you should know. And that's if you're trying to depose a corporation. And this is tricky because a corporation is typically made up of a ton of people, unless you're a solo practitioner, virtual lawyer, and it's just you. But in either event, let's say you're trying to depose a massive blue chip corporation. The question is, okay, who's going to actually be the deponent? And what you need to do is typically send what's commonly referred to, especially in the federal context, is a 30B6. That's B as in Bob. And I'll put some of the links or the citations down below for you to check out. A 30B6 notice of deposition. And what you're doing with this 30B6 is not only are you sending a notice of deposition, but you're including an exhibit that lists all the topics of conversation. By providing this context within the exhibit, it should benefit both sides. With the corporation, it gives them a heads up on who they should elect as the corporate representative so they can ultimately have that person prepare in advance of the topics, make sure that they're qualified in order to talk about those topics. And that way on your end, if you're taking the deposition, it allows you to have a productive deposition because once you're asking questions, you want quality answers instead of a whole bunch of, well, I don't know, that's a different department. I have no idea. Now, if this is your first time dealing with the deposition of a corporate representative, you may be thinking, okay, how specific or how broad do these topics of conversation need to be? That's a fair question. And if you're the one taking the deposition, you want to be as broad as possible. If you're the one defending the deposition, then obviously you want it to be as specific as possible. There's that sweet spot to where you don't really have to, you know, put your entire potential deposition questions in that exhibit topics of conversation list, but you also don't want to be too generic and broad to where it's like, hey, I'm gonna talk about everything that this corporation has done in the last 10 years. And so there's that sweet spot that you may have to confer with opposing counsel to make sure that everyone's on the same page. And then whenever you are asking your questions in the deposition, you're allowed to basically have those questions of conversations asked, keeping in mind that if you're too specific and you ask a question that's outside of what you were specifying, then you're obviously most likely gonna raise an objection to where the opposing counsel is gonna say, well, they're speaking in their individual capacity if they know, they're not speaking on behalf of the corporation because this topic wasn't covered in the 30B6 notice of deposition. So all that to say, find that sweet spot. And if you're curious on not only what does a typical notice of deposition look like, or what does a federal deposition of notice look like, or what does a 30B6 notice of deposition look like, I'll try and find some examples, some samples, so you can build on that and make sure you can tweak some things in order for it to apply to your jurisdiction down below. So check those out. So let's go through the quick checklist of what your notice of deposition needs to include. It needs to include who you're wanting to depose. It should also include where the deposition is going to occur and what time. And don't forget to include the how. For example, you may have a court reporter there, or you may just take the video deposition without the court reporter, or maybe you have a combination of the two. By the way, if your jurisdiction has any weird formalities when it comes to getting a deposition set up, or weird languages, different terms, or if there's something that you think needs to be brought up, be sure to leave those in the comments section down below. I can't stress this enough. Before you send that notice of deposition, please, please, please call opposing counsel and see if you can get everything agreed to before you send that notice of deposition. Because once you send that notice, then that's going to put the other side with their back against the wall to where they have to come up with a response, or they have to try and rearrange their schedule in order for it to work, or they may have to get the court involved in order to get things smoothed out. And they will most likely return the quote favor by sending a notice of deposition that probably isn't going to work best for you. And so I recommend you reach out to opposing counsel and start by figuring out what day works best. And if you can lock down the day, then it's a matter of, okay, what time works best? If you can lock down the time, then okay, where exactly are we gonna take this deposition? And the location is sometimes gonna be an issue, sometimes not. Unfortunately, the federal rules are, I'll say, a little confusing when it comes to figuring out who exactly can determine the location. It's pretty silent on the location aspect, and contrast that with the state of Texas, where there are a list of potential options for the person who's wanting to take the deposition to choose the location for the deposition of the party or the witness. And so with that, you know, concrete list, it allows there to be a little bit more hard hitting of like, yeah, opposing counsel, I know you want to take the deposition or have the deposition over here, but we're actually by statute allowed to have it right here. Again, you know, apply the here and there for whatever situation you have. But the hope here is that you can get all of this agreed to. Again, check your jurisdiction to figure out if you can maybe use the statute to try and have the location be a little bit more convenient to where it's closer for you to attend, which if it's closer, then maybe that allows you to save some money for your client because maybe you're not having to fly somewhere. Maybe you can have it at your office. That can be a whole lot better than opposing counsel saying, hey, we have to have it across the country because that's where, you know, the client is, the corporation is. Again, check your statute, figure out exactly what's going to apply. And I definitely recommend you check all this out in advance of calling opposing counsel. That way, if there is any pushback, then you can basically say, hey, this statute allows me to do X, Y, and Z. And then you can push on it a little harder than, you know, other aspects of it, like the date and the time and all that. Or you can say, maybe we can meet a middle ground. Maybe we do a virtual deposition to where everyone can do it from the comfort of their own home. Everyone's wearing their comfy pants and just looking professional from the waist up. It's a weird world that we're living in to where virtual is becoming extremely convenient. But the point here is that with the notice of deposition, try and get everything ironed out in advance, because if you send that notice, then it's gonna make things a little bit more contentious when they don't have to be. I will say there may be a situation where opposing counsel is ghosting you, or maybe a witness isn't responding, and so you're not able to meet and confer about these details to include in the notice of deposition. If that's the case, if you make a good faith effort, then go ahead and notice the deposition, and that will most likely trigger a response. And once you get that response, then at that point, meet and confer about the specifics with that particular deposition and see if you can iron out those details, and then follow up that meet and confer with an amended notice of deposition. And that way things still aren't as contentious as they could be if you're just trying to force everyone's hand. I do want to circle back to virtual depositions, most likely a Zoom deposition. That's the most popular today. If you're watching this in the future and if Zoom is dead, then be sure to let me know in the comments down below. And that shows how old this particular video is. Or maybe it's Zoom's out of business. I don't know. Anyways, the point here is that with virtual depositions, be sure to include in the notice of deposition of whether or not it is a virtual deposition. And so what's tricky there is your location is just going to be virtual deposition, or it'll say something like, you know, comfort of your own home. Not really, but you get the point. So the tricky part really with virtual depositions is the risk of there being technical issues is exponentially higher than with a traditional deposition. And so I always recommend, not only if you're going to have a third party host the Zoom deposition, be sure that they are able to contact the third party to make sure the opposing party or the witness is able to access everything, you know, have the right Zoom password, have the right Zoom link, have everything be compatible, and they can work with the third party separately. Or if you're the one hosting the virtual deposition, let's say, you know, you have a Zoom account, and in that situation, I would still send, you know, the password and the links in advance. No matter what, I strongly, strongly recommend that you always send a follow-up email, I don't know, a week before the deposition, and beg and plead basically that everyone across the board checks their technology, make sure everything's compatible, make sure the internet is going to be sufficient, because the last thing you want is for all the stars to align to where everyone's schedule works, you have it planned, you've been, you know, working through the discovery process, and then there's a delay because the witnesses or the party's internet isn't working and it's not fast enough. And so you want to be able to make, you know, whatever pivots you need to make in advance of having that actual deposition just completely implode. Along those lines, I do recommend that you also work out kind of how exhibits are going to be introduced. And that way both sides are on the same page with, okay, do the exhibits need to be sent in advance? Do exhibits need to be sent afterwards? Do the exhibits need to be sent to the court reporter in advance? Do the exhibits need to be sent to the court reporter afterwards? All of that. And finally, I do recommend you do another thing as well. Talk about the rules, parameters, protocols, whatever you want to call it, in advance of the virtual deposition. For example, and this shouldn't be an issue, but who knows, make sure it's clear that if you have, let's say, a witness or you have a party who you're deposing, that the opposing counsel isn't in the same room. And you know, you basically don't want to have the opposing counsel shaking his head yes or shaking his head no, and the witness saying, oh, yes. And so you want to make sure you can see everything from your Zoom perspective. And so by having people in different rooms, that's the best way to do it. Another parameter is figuring out whether or not other people have the ability, or even you have the ability, to record it. Make sure that's agreed to. So all these little nitpicky rules to where you want to make sure everything is kosher and nobody's taking advantage of the situation. That's all something you should sort out in advance and not in the moment on game day. And a quick heads up, if you're not able to confer about the exact date of the deposition, let's say the witness or opposing counsel has just ghosted on you, so you're having to send out that notice of deposition, in that situation, look at your local jurisdictional rules to figure out what's considered like a reasonable time for that date of that deposition to occur. Some jurisdictions simply vaguely state that it needs to occur a reasonable time after the notice. Other jurisdictions, like the federal court, I believe has a 14-day requirement where it has to be at least 14 days from the notice. Again, check your jurisdiction and make sure you comply. Okay, so that is kind of your general checklist with the formalities involving getting your deposition set up. If any others pop in my mind, if any others come up in the comment section, I'll be sure to expand on those down below in the body of the lesson. But the point here and the overarching theme is to check the formalities in your jurisdiction, check those boxes off, and then go dominate your deposition. And that starts in the next lesson.